education. When Kim was 15, his father allowed him to withdraw from the school because he was so unhappy there and so much disliked by the other boys and their parents. "I don't want that boy in the house again," said Colonel Greenfield. "He looks like a sheep-killing dog." "It is a walking corpse," said a St. Louis matron poisonously. Years later, Kim settled that account. When informed of her death, he said, "It isn't every corpse that can walk, hers can't." "The boy is rotten clear through, and he stinks like a polecat," Judge Ferris pontificated. But this was more or less true. When angered, aroused, or excited, Kim flushed bright red and steamed off a rank, a ruddish animal smell. "The child is not wholesome," said Mr. Kindheart in his usual restraint. Kim was the most unpopular boy in the school, if not in the town of St. Louis. "Well, they got nothing to teach you anyway," his father said. "Why, the headmaster's a fucking priest." The summers they spent at the farm, and Kim loved squirrel hunting in the early morning, and usually went hunting with Jerry Ellisor, who lived next door, because Jerry had a slinky black hound dog. And everybody knows you can't find any squirrels without a dog to bark up the tree where a squirrel is. Kim remembers a friend of his father's, an unobtrusively wealthy man who traveled all over the world studying unusual methods of hand-to-hand fighting. And he wrote a book about it. Kim remembers him as looking very safe and happy. He could kill anyone in sight, and he knew it. And that was a good feeling. The book was fascinating. Chinese practitioners who can kill with a soft, twisting blow just in the right place and at the right time. The soft touch, it is called. Kim hummed the funeral march happily. And a magnificent, sulky old Indian who specialized in a lightning blow to the testicles. The golden target, he called it. "He was the most unpleasant man I have ever met," the writer reports. "After a scant quarter hour in his company, I was impotent for a full week." So the writer, he tries to impress this old Midas by breaking a stack of bricks with his karate chop. And the Indian sets up an equal stack and adds one brick. Then he just sort of lightly thumps the stack. And the writer points a finger at the top brick, which is undamaged. The old practitioner lifts the top brick. All the bricks under it have been shattered as if hit by a sledgehammer. And a bartender in Paris had fashioned a weapon from his breath. By taking certain herbs, he had developed a breath so pestiferous that. Then, standing almost 6 feet away, he breathed on me. Words cannot convey the vertiginous, retching horror that enveloped me as I lost consciousness. And for days after, I shuddered at the memory of that awesome breath. Well, he beats the skunk at his own game, but generally speaking, when it comes down to hand, teeth, claw, poison, quill, shark, fighting, animals beat humans in any direction. So Kim had a course thought of living weapons, but the only animal has been taught to attack reliably on commands the dog, though many other animals be vastly more efficient as fighting machines. The bobcat, the lynx, the incomparable wolverine that can drive a bear from its kill. Kim looked in disdain at Jerry's dog Rover, a skulking, cowardly, inefficient animal. Kim usually spotted the squirrel before Rover could sniff it out. When Jerry wasn't around, Kim would corner Rover and transfix him with his witch stares. He intoned, "Bad dog." And Rover begins to cower and cringe and whimper. And finally, desperate to ingratiate himself, he rolls on his back and pisses all over himself. While Kim enjoyed this spectacle, It was not enough to compensate for the continuous proximity of this filthy, fawning, vicious, shit-eating beast. No, but then, who am I to be critical, Kim thought philosophically. Kevin just read a juicy story about African medicine men who capture hyenas and blind them with red-hot needles and burn out their vocal cords as they intone certain spells, binding the tortured animals to their will to fashion a silent, dedicated instrument of death. Kim looks speculatively at Rover and licks his lips. And Rover creeps whimpering behind Jerry's legs. The colonel fills his pipe. They attacked at dawn like gray shadows. I saw a boy go down hamstrung. Next thing, his throat is ripped out. I couldn't see what was doing. It was like a ghost attack. But the boys knew, and the cry went up, "Shmoons! Shmoons!" That's the native word for hyenas blinded by the beastly medicine men. Now, we intended to capture a male gorilla. The mountain species there are somewhat smaller than the lowland breeds. So we had a cage just so big and big enough that I managed to nip into it and lock the door. I'll never forget my boys pleading to be let in as the hyenas tore them apart. That sight will haunt me to my dying day. Couldn't chance it, you know. One boy was in the door and that would have been it. The blind animal panicked. They couldn't understand my position. They screamed curses at me. Well, Kim put it, what can you expect from people with no breeding? Oh, yes, of course, exactly. Kipling, you know, the writer chap, speaks of the lesser breed without the law. Awfully depressing, all that.